All right. Good to be in the house of the Lord today, man. Man, it's Palm Sunday, and so welcome. We're super excited to have Gary Wilkerson and his crew in the house. You guys are going to be blessed today. Also, we have prepared a Holy Week packet for you. It's got this cool string, and you can do things so you guys as a family can celebrate this entire week. We also have some new merch in the back, so go check that out. This Wednesday, we're not going to have any service. We're going to be over at Lakeside getting ready for Easter Sunday. But we will have a Good Friday service this Friday at 6:30. So no service Wednesday night, but come on Friday. It's going to be great. Also, if you have a student that's planning on going to church camp, we need those forms back this week, all right? Listen, this Easter is going to be special. I want to just challenge you to bring your friends to Lakeside this Sunday. Why don't you check out this video?
Hey, it's Pastor Matt and Pastor Emily from Lakeview Assembly, and we are so excited about Easter this year. We are partnered with Lakeside School District, and we're going to have one big giant service at Lakeside Performing Arts Center. It is such a beautiful big building, and we can finally all be together as one Lakeview family.
So on March 31st at 10:30 a.m., we will all gather right here. There's going to be great things for the whole family. We want you to bring your babies. We'll have childcare from babies up to age 6. And then I'm going to have a kids section in the sanctuary for your ages 7 to 12. And I would love to have them sit with me. There's just going to be a great worship experience for the whole family. We're going to make sure every person, all ages, are ministered to that day, and we just can't wait to get in God's presence. It's going to be an awesome day.
That's right. So you are invited, and not only are you invited, you and your family and friends are invited as well. So we just want you to feel welcome and to come hear the message of King Jesus, how he overcame it all. And there's going to be so much hope in the room. And so if you're looking for hope, we have a message for you. And so we can't wait to introduce you to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So we just want to encourage you to invite a friend, invite your family, and just come together and worship Jesus with us. And we can't wait for Easter Sunday.
Amen. Good morning, everybody. Easter next weekend is going to be so amazing, so amazing. Go ahead and stand to your feet. We're going to enter into a time of worship together. Guys, we've had an incredible morning. First service was so awesome, and it's just going to be an incredible service again this morning. Let's just stand in this place and just get our hearts right and our posture right. Let's just for a moment just begin to gaze on Jesus, to acknowledge him, to worship him for a moment. Where you're standing, just begin to lift your hands in this place. We just shake off any distractions. We just get our heart right. Lord, we worship you this morning. We worship you. Guys, open up your mouths. Begin to just give them praise this morning. Yeah, Lord, we just raise our anticipation, our expectation to be with you and in your presence this morning, God, as a family, Lord. Yeah, Lord, we honor you. We worship you in this place. We shout with a voice of triumph. We shout, Hosanna, King of Kings. You are welcome here. You are welcome here. And everybody said, Amen. Let's worship. I've got a reason to praise.
control. My praise is a weapon. It's more than a sound.
Our praise is a shout. Come on.
Our praise is a shout that brings Jericho down.
As long as
I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord. Oh, my soul, just praise the Lord. Oh, my soul,
I won't be quiet.
I won't be quiet. My God is alive. How could I keep it inside?
Come on, we sing.
We praise 'cause you're sovereign. Praise 'cause you reign. Praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave. Praise 'cause you're faithful. Praise 'cause you're true. Praise 'cause there's nobody greater than you. We sing. Praise 'cause you're sovereign. Praise 'cause you reign. Praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave. Oh, praise 'cause you're faithful. Praise 'cause you're true.
We're gonna do it again.
Praise 'cause there's nobody.
Come on.
We praise 'cause you're sovereign. We praise 'cause you reign. Praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave. Praise 'cause you're faithful. Praise 'cause you're true.
Here we go.
Praise 'cause there's nobody greater than you. Praise the Lord.
Come on, we lift our voice. You sing.
Just praise the Lord. This all my soul. Yes, I won't be quiet. My God is alive. How could I keep it inside? Yes, I won't be quiet. My God is alive. How could I keep it?
No, I won't be quiet.
Yes, I won't be quiet. My God is alive. How could I keep it inside?
Come
Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. You wear the victor's crown. You wear the victor's crown. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Can we sing that together? Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. You wear, and you wear the victor's crown. One more time, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Come on, sing it out from your heart. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. We lift our eyes to you.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there is peace within your presence as I speak Jesus. And I just want to speak the name of Jesus, every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus.
Your name, your name.
Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness, over every enemy. To Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name. of Jesus.
Come on, come on, come on, come on, Jesus, come on.
Shout Jesus from the mountain, Jesus in the streets. Oh, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. There's Jesus for my family.
Power in his name. There's power in his name. Shout it, shout it, shout it, shout it.
Shout Jesus from the mountains.
Jesus.
Jesus in the streets. Jesus in the darkness.
Just press in right here for a moment. Worship our King of Kings. We usher in our King, our mighty and beautiful and glorious King. With fire in his eyes. It's how glorious, how marvelous, how filled with splendor. As we make straight every path for this King of Kings, this Lord of Lords. His kingdom is coming. Oh, his kingdom is coming. The King is here. The King is here. Oh, alleluia. It's God, you're here. The King is here. The King is here. Oh, hallelujah. Come on, lift your hands in this place. We usher in the King of Kings.
The King is here. The King is here. Oh, hallelujah.
God,
come on, take it to him.
Shout Jesus from the mountains.
Jesus in the streets.
Oh, Jesus in the darkness. For every enemy. Jesus for my family.
I speak the holy name of Jesus. Oh, shout Jesus.
Oh, shout Jesus from
sing it together. And oh, how wonderful, and oh, how marvelous, and our song shall ever be. And oh, how wonderful, and oh, how marvelous is my Savior, whose love for me. Come on, let's sing it again. How wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Ooh, there's freedom in the room. There's freedom in the room. Freedom in the room.
Of the Lord is there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And every chain is broken through you, Jesus. It's where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And with unveiled faces, we behold your glory. We behold your beauty,
freedom. Whoa. Whoa.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, and Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness, over every enemy. Oh, Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name of Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, and Jesus in the streets, and Jesus in the darkness,
for every enemy.
And Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name of Jesus.
Come on, we're moving into a place of intercession right now for our cities, for our neighbors, for our prodigal children, that the freedom we've experienced of our chains and shackles hitting the floor, that they would be able to experience that for themselves through the love and blood of Jesus Christ. So Lord, we just ask, fling open the doors of the church, and that your love would flood this city, Lord. That our children and their children's children would no longer be bound, would no longer be shackled. That they would know that a good shepherd's leading them on. And that a good rabbi is teaching would actually take root and lead us in a kingdom of God, a kingdom of heaven, here in our nation, in our cities, Lord, in our families, Lord. We're not just singing songs on a Sunday. We're declaring freedom. Yes, we declare freedom. We declare freedom. Yes, freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, oh, there is freedom. Whoever's been washed by the blood of Jesus, made new, made alive. Oh, thank you, Lord. Shout Jesus, come on.
Shout Jesus from
the mountains. Jesus in the streets.
Jesus in the darkness.
Hallelujah, God, you're here.
Yes, we behold
'Cause His name is power, His name is healing, His name is life. To break every stronghold, to shine through the burn light. Yes, Your name is power, Your name. I just feel that burden on my heart to just pray over if anybody's experienced freedom in here and what it feels like for a weight to come off, for a shackle to hit the floor, for like the cling of the shackle to hit the floor, and how powerful that just that sound is. And I even just picture the captives, like it gets harder to run faster when you get older. But just full-fledged, like what that felt like as a child to just let your wheels just go. And I feel like that is just in the room, that there's captives experiencing freedom for the first time in the room, and you don't actually know what to do with yourself. You don't actually remember what it was to be free and run and let your wheels just go. And so let's just stay in this moment for a second. If you are experiencing what I'm talking about, I just want you to lift your hands. This is the first time you feel like, oh my gosh, this shackle's hit the floor next to me and I don't know what to do with it. I know this is vulnerable. I know it's taking boldness. I see a hand here. There's a hand here. Man, let's just be I see a hand here. Let's just be the body for a second. Let's love on these brothers and sisters. Let's just put our hands on them. Let's pray for them. And continue to pray that prayer that wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, that there is freedom. That there is freedom. If you're not near somebody, just begin to press into the Lord just for another moment. Just to thank Him for His power and His kindness and His leading. Go after the one, Jesus. Wow. Let you go after the one, Lord. Cravings of the flesh are being taken away now. You've tasted this living water, and you'll begin to pant again for this water. Thank you. We're just going to wait for another moment. Just another moment. It's when we wait upon the Lord, He renews our strength. Sing that chorus together one more time, just voices. Your name.
It's your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is Lord. To break every
now have their hope, and the orphans
Come on, for all he's done.
For all that you've done, we will pour out our love this week. Our anthem song, oh Jesus.
Come on, sing it out.
Shoulder of someone next to you, and let's just intercede, God, that you would open our hearts to receive the words of the living God today. That God, that the eyes of our heart would be opened to perceive you and all you want to do in our lives, in our city. Man, I just feel like the Lord is saying that he wants to expand our vision. Moving us past just our little world. He's given us eyes to see the world. God, that you would enlarge our borders, not for our sake, but for yours. Not for our glory, but for yours, oh God. And God, we'll step into anything that you call us to step into, no matter how scary or risky. I love it. Give somebody a hug. Tell them you love them. Amen. 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 Good to see everybody. Looking forward to Easter. Remember Easter? We will not be here, 10:30 at Lakeside Performing Arts Center. Have one service where we can all be together, and we're looking forward to that. An egg hunt on the football field afterwards. We're looking forward to that. Just want to lean right in and give our speaker plenty of time where he can do whatever he wants to do. This is a bucket list for me to have Pastor Gary and his wife Kelly here. You've got no idea. No idea. As a young man, I just got on fire for the Lord. And I thought for a while that something was wrong with me. but I had other people in my life that said, no, something's right with you. Keep leaning into that. And so I started being handed resources and different things, and I was handed a copy of The Cross and the Switchblade. And I read that story, and I go, oh my gosh, there's more out there of people that are like just on fire for the Lord and just want to do anything for his glory. So as a young man, I scraped my pennies together from being a youth pastor and got a plane ticket to New York and went to Times Square Church as a young man, a little turnip seed going to Times Square. You should have seen it. I'm on the subway like, what is happening here? I don't even know. It was like a pilgrimage for me. And I got to hear your dad minister. It was actually at the 50th anniversary of the Teen Challenge in 2008. And Nikki Cruz was there and different things. And I'm like, and so I got to be a part of that. And so I'll just never forget that experience watching your dad just like, flow in the Holy Spirit, and just the anointing and the mantle was on him. And I was just like, oh, I'm like a 22-year-old going, God, give me that. I want that. That's what I want. And it was just beautiful. And then to now have his son here who's taken the baton and running the race so well, I mean, for me, this is just like, I'm like a little nervous, actually, like right now. Like, this is so cool because of what's on their life and the Jesus that's in them. And so would you just make them feel so welcome and so honored as Pastor Gary comes up.
Thank you. You may be seated. You'll have to excuse me. I have a cough drop in my mouth. I've been fighting off a little bit of a cold. I was up till about 4 o'clock this morning, tossing and turning and aches and pains and stuff. And then my wife prayed for me, and she got me about 80% better. So if there's anybody that has that finishing touch here in the church today, you can... You can pray for me. Pastor Matthew, thank you so much for allowing us to be here. We're real honored to be in a place that reverences and honors and exalts and lifts up the name of Jesus above all other names. It's not the name of your church. It's not the name of your pastor. It's the name of Jesus. Jesus, we exalt you. We thank you for your presence. We thank you. We love you. We honor you. I pray that... the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart would not only be acceptable to you, God, but they would promote your purposes and your desires for this day. Give us ears to hear. In Jesus' name, amen. Rob and Lisa Lau are good friends. I work with World Challenge. You guys would wave. Rob and Lisa. And then this is my wife. This is my wife, Kelly. Kelly, if you'd wave, stand, turn, whatever you... twist and shout. We've been married for 45 years, and thank you. I'm a blessed man. I tell you, all you look at her, you go like, how did I score something like that? You know, just like she's incredible. And 4 children, all married, all following Jesus, 11 grandkids. 12th on the way. Any of our grandkids that are old enough to understand the things of the Lord have come to know Jesus. Recently, our 3-year-old, Laney James is his name, Laney James Holloway. He came home from church about 3 weeks ago, maybe a month ago, and he had a little sticker on his shirt and said, I invited Jesus into my heart today. I thought that was so sweet. And my daughter asked Laney, said, Laney, can you tell me what happened? He goes, sure, Mom. We were at church, and the teacher said, Jesus wants to come into our heart. So I said, hi, Jesus. My name's Laney James. And I said, and Jesus said, hi, I'm Jesus. And Laney said, well, if you'd like to come into my heart, you can. And Jesus said, sure, I would love to come into your heart. And as a matter of fact, I'm going to bring you a monster truck as well. I think that might have been his way of hinting at his mom was supposed to get him a monster truck. But what a joy it is to see your family. It's not always been that way. We've had some prodigals, as many of you have, too. You know, sometimes, when you hear somebody like me get up here and say, you know, 4 children all serving the Lord, all their spouses serving the Lord, 11 grandchildren serving the Lord, you go like, man, I've got some prodigals. I wonder what's wrong. And... but don't fret, don't worry. We had prodigals, and Jesus brought them home, and miracles take place. So having had prodigal children, the Lord has given us even a greater compassion for people that, who are in need of breakthroughs in their own family. So we'd be glad to pray with you today as well, if family members wanting to come to know Jesus. Speaking of my wife, occasionally I send her a text. I find Bible verses, like a couple days ago, Proverbs 31. There are many excellent women, but you excel over them all. And I sent that to her, trying to see if she'll cook me my favorite. It's called Kelly's Chicken. That's the ulterior motive that I'm working on there. But I do that. But about 2 weeks ago, our water heater at home blew up, and it flooded our basement, and we called a plumber, and he came over pretty quick and fixed it. the woman who was the staff there that was arranging the events that was going on. pardon me. I'm so sorry. You okay? Now you're coughing. I got. So I meant to text my wife. I was texting my wife, and it's from the book of Judges, and Samson saw these women. So he goes and says, and Samson went among the women, and he saw one woman, and she was right in his eyes. So I texted my wife saying, "Baby, you are," and I like in big long letters, "You baby, you are right in my eyes," like R-I-G-I-T-T-T-T-T, right in my eyes. Unfortunately, I didn't send it to Kelly. I sent it to the plumber. and the secretary there. And so she texted me back the emoji with a confused-looking face. And then the plumber who fixed our hot water heater, he texted me back, goes, "That is so cool. I'm going to use that on my wife this weekend." So... There's actually a reason I told you that, not just to tell you a funny story, but it's getting the right message is really important, but getting the right message to the right people at the right time is really important as well. The Bible calls it a word in season, right? And so as preachers here, Pastor Matthew and I, we know this, you can have a really good, we can have a really good message, but it's not the one God wants you to speak at that time, or... There's something you can have a really, in your own estimation, it's not a really very good message, but you know God wants you to speak it. This one, I'm not prepared. I don't have anything for that. I don't have any notes. I didn't spend a week studying it, but you know God wants to do that. So that's what I want to do today with you. In the first service, I preached a different message, and just between services here, the Lord just put on my heart. I don't know why. Maybe there's some people here in this room that need to hear this instead of what I shared this morning, but we're just going to obey the Holy Spirit and get into His word. I want to also say to you, happy Palm Sunday. What a great week we have, as we call it Holy Week. We're about to just recognize all that Jesus has done for us. We're about to see, and I want to encourage you to invite some friends next week. That's going to be, you're going to have a great time. You have a great time here. Could you imagine being all together at once with... And you guys, please don't tell anybody in the first service I said this, okay? But you guys can encourage the first service. Thank you. Very kind. All right. So in Matthew chapter 21, if you remember the story, this is the triumphal entry, and Jesus comes riding in on what? On a donkey, not a majestic steed, not a royal king's horse, but in the humility of a colt. Not even a big donkey who has proven himself, but a little colt that's never been ridden before. And Jesus told his disciples, "Go in verse 2, go and you're going to find a donkey, a colt with her. Now bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, 'The Lord needs them,' and we will send them at once." And it took place to fulfill what was prophesied. It's in the book of Zechariah, chapter 9, verse 9 and 10. "Say to the daughter of Zion, 'Behold, your king is coming, humble and mounted on a donkey and a colt, the foal of a beast of burden.'" An elephant... It's a great way to start a sermon, isn't it? An elephant, has a baby elephant after 2 years of pregnancy, and all the women in the church go, "Oh God, no!" 2 years of having a baby elephant in your womb, and they can only have another elephant 2 years after they give birth to that one. So it's every 4 years they can have another elephant. So elephants are, if you've ever seen an elephant before, if there's ever been an elephant in your neighborhood, you probably didn't miss it, right? Or if you go to a zoo and there's an elephant stall there, you're going to see elephants. They're hard to miss. They're very predominant. They're very present. They're big. They're grand. They're majestic in a way. But they kind of reproduce slowly. And that's why there's so few of them in the world. On the other hand, rabbits can have once a month can have not just one other rabbit, but up to 12 rabbits. So, and all the women in the church said, "God, please no." I didn't tell you this just to like give you like make you feel like, wow, he knows a lot about animals. That's really, there's a meaning to this. Is elephants are big and grand and glorious, but rabbits really get a lot done all around the world. You know, they're just out there and they're reproducing and they're you know, you probably don't see too many. Are there a lot of elephants in hot springs, like walking down the street? Probably not, but there's probably a lot of rabbits, right? And they reproduce quickly and they move. And I say that to say, I think the church in our nation, a lot of us in leadership, want our church to be an elephant. Big, bold, impressive, a lot of notoriety. Really, really, like, you can see them, what they're doing. But I think maybe Jesus wants more rabbits. And it's not just for pastors and churches. It's for us in our life, too. I want to be self-promoted. I want to have a name. I want to be popular. I want to be famous. I want to be rich. I want to have all my needs met. That's the elephant mentality. Bigger is better. And being visually known by other people, having a large Facebook following. That's one of the curses of this generation, of the competition of how many people follow you and how many likes do you get per post. So you see all that taking place today in the church, in our families, in our own life. In the missions work that we do at World Challenge, there's two nations we work in, and both of them are for many decades, the fastest growing church in the world was in, anybody guess? China. Thank you. That's a great guess. Nobody guessed. The fastest growing church has been for decades in China. But there's very few elephant churches in China. Do you know of, like, do you know of, there's no, like, elevation worship in China. You know, there's no Hillsong in China. It's like, you know, Sister Chan, you know, sings a song a cappella with 30 people in the room. But it's one of the fastest growing churches in the world. It's no longer the fastest growing church because Iran, isn't that bizarre? Iran has surpassed China as the fastest growing church in the world. And they have, amen? Yeah. And they have no elephants. They have rabbits. They're just good people who love Jesus with all their heart, serving him without desiring to make a name for themselves. So Jesus in Palm Sunday tells his disciples, don't get me a white horse. That's coming later. I'm coming back to judge on a white horse with a sword in my mouth and blood on my robe. But right now, we're coming in this generation. Until I come back, we're going to come. The Church of Jesus Christ is going to come in humility. Humility is one of the keys to reaching this generation. Humility is one of the keys to having a faithful, godly, holy church. To be a holy person, you can't be a holy person and exist in pride. The Lord will cause the pride to, what comes after pride? A fall. In Proverbs 16, though, on the opposite end, what comes after humility? Honor. Thank you. Some of you know honor comes out in Proverbs 16. And a lot of us know that pride leads to a fall, but we don't realize that humility leads to honor. And we're not trying to be humble. Like, I'm gonna work my humility here really hard so that I could get honored. That's sort of the opposite of actual real humility. Is like, I'm not in this for the honor. I'm in this for the King, and so that He'd be honored. But in His goodness, He does honor people who honor him and blesses them. So he comes in humility. Jesus described his heart in Scripture only one time, And as he, and it's the only time he actually described what his heart was like. And he uses two words to describe what his heart like. Anybody know what those two words? Humble and lowly. Isn't that crazy? Jesus could have described himself majestic and powerful, healing and delivering, authority and anointing. He says, brothers and sisters, do you want to know my heart? And do you want to be Christ-like? Then know this about me. My heart is humble and lowly. What an aspiration to be lowly. And I'm seeing that in this generation, there are young people who are starting to come to our churches or have been in our churches for a while, and they're tired of the show and the hype and the entertainment and just everything kind of a big buzz. And it's not that God is against or this generation is against big things. The churches can have tens of thousands of people and still have the humble spirit about it. But so it's not a matter of whether it's a big church or a small church. It's a matter, is that church walking in humility? A friend of mine called me and said, hey, Gary, I want you to get on a Zoom call with my friend named Zach. My friend Mac called me and said, would you spend 30, 45 minutes with Zach? And I said, well, who's Zach? He said, Zach is the young pastor. He's 32 years old, and he's been the pastor at Asbury University, and he does the chapel services there. And I said, well, what happened? And they said, well, Zach was preaching at Asbury, and when he got done preaching, he was preaching from Romans chapter 12, and when he got done, he felt like, I don't know if you ever feel this way, Pastor Matthew, after a sermon's done, you feel like, that was a terrible sermon. And everybody in your church is shaking their heads, no. Like, no, he never has a terrible sermon. You should have said amen right there, church. You missed it. It's too late now. So he texted his wife. He actually walks off the side of the stage, and he's texting as he's leaving. And he said, hey, honey, I'll be home in 15 minutes. I laid another stinker today, thinking about his sermon. And as he's walking off the stage, some kids from Asbury University walk up to the front of the stage, and they get on their knees. He actually counted. He says, I don't know why he counted. There's 19 kids who came forward, and Zach just turns around, well, let me just kneel at the altar and pray with him. And he prayed for a little while, prayed for a half hour, prayed for an hour, and when he kind of got up off his knees, he looked, there was like 60 kids praying there in the thing. And if you know the story, right? You know the story. Later on, there was 100, then 1,000, and then before long, I think he said at one point, there was over 250,000 people on the campus lined up, having prayer meetings outside, having prayer meetings on the streets. And the reason, I have a chance to talk to Zach on the phone. He said the reason we finally stopped it after, I think it was maybe, I don't know, it was 13 or 16 days, the reason we stopped it is because the city called us and said, our sewer system's back up because you have too many people in this small city. And so... And our water tanks are depleted, so we just, you know, people are going to come here and they're not going to be able to drink anything and they're not going to be able to go to the bathroom. And so they finally stopped it. Otherwise, it probably would have continued on. But anyway, my friend Matt said, so why don't you call Zach and talk to him? And I said to my friend Matt, I don't think so. He said, why not? He goes, and here's what I said. It's because I don't think I need revival. I kind of live in revival. I read my Bible. I'm hungry for Jesus. I'm passionate about prayer. I love to reach out to the lost. My church is my family. I kind of feel like, you know, we're looking for some special thing to happen when maybe we just need to just live, you know, like live a holy life and pray and seek his face and know him and love one another and reach out to people that don't know Jesus and give. So as I'm saying this, he says, well, just call him anyway. So I call Zach and I told him that. I said, hey, you know, I'm glad you guys are experiencing revival. I don't need revival. And as soon as I said it, oh my goodness. I don't know whether it was something that God put in this young man as he just shared a few words about what God was doing in his own heart, about humility and just coming and bowing before the Lord and waiting, just waiting simply and quietly on the Lord. All of a sudden I got convicted. It's like, oh my goodness. Gary, you are so arrogant. You are so... Did somebody just say right? You don't even know me and you're accusing me. But that's what the Holy Spirit was saying to me. So you are right. It convicted me. How arrogant, how prideful can you be? Oh, I don't need revival. I'm in tune all the time. I always got it together. I'm always on fire for God. I don't need supernatural revivals to take place. And the Lord just broke my heart and convicted me. And ever since that day, there's been this stirring in my heart to chase after humility, to get rid of the pride and the arrogance in my heart, the things that are unlike Jesus, that don't have the Spirit of Christ in them, that are just... And so Zach was telling me that this generation is done with the show. It's done with the entertainment. What it wants is the presence of Jesus. It doesn't need eloquent preachers. It doesn't need Elevation or Hillsong worship teams to get them going. It's just a guitar, and that revival was just guitar, you know, some guitars, simple praying, seeking after Jesus. That there's a hunger, and he went on to just tell us that several things that they realized that were part of the reason God was moving so much was, number one, the leadership was nameless and faceless, that they didn't want to promote themselves. As a matter of fact, my friend, who's become a good friend of mine now, Zach, told me that after the revival, his phone lit up. Invitations all over the world. Come and preach at my conference. Come and preach at my church. And the Lord spoke to him and said, for the next 3 months, I don't want you to accept one invitation because you're not going to market this thing. You're not going to build a reputation off of what I did. You didn't do it. I did it. And I thank the Lord that this 32-year-old man was humble enough to say, Lord, I'll take my hands off of it. I don't need to be known. I don't need a face. I don't need a name. This is a revival that's going to happen. This generation is going to be nameless and faceless. It's not going to be big superstars. It's not going to be rock star bands. It's going to be the people in the presence of God, the rabbits all over the world. Thousands and thousands of little rabbits going around making a difference in the world. And that excites me so much because as soon as I start aspiring to be an elephant, everything goes wrong. I want to be bigger, better, known, famous. I want people to applaud me. I want big crowds. I want to sell a lot of books. I want to have a lot of people follow. As soon as I start chasing after that, the presence of the Lord diminishes. Because he doesn't bless the pride, the proud. He blesses the humble. And so as he convicts me and my heart responds to that conviction, and I say, God, there's such a deep work you've got to do in me. And I tell you, it's hard. It's hard. I mean, Teen Challenge was here this morning, and it's hard to get off heroin or crack or cocaine or methamphetamines, but it's harder to get off pride. It really is. Man, this thing struggles with me. It's like when I do pastors' conferences around the world, and I invite some of my good friends to come and preach with me. And I'll be sitting in the front row, and Carter Conlon, if you've ever heard of him from Times Square Church, I'll be praying, Lord, bless Pastor Carter. Lord, give him a word. And he gets up there and he starts preaching, and the crowd just going wild, like, hallelujah, amen. And standing and applauding, going like, Lord, not so much. I mean, save a little bit for me. I have another friend who just got involved in a new ministry, and I'm almost embarrassed to say this. I follow him on social media, and I looked at his account, and like within a couple months, it just blew up. You know, like from 2,000 to like 50,000, and mine's like not. And this lack of humility, the lack of conviction over humility, causes other things to sprout in our heart. So for me, it was jealousy. I'm jealous of my friend. And what does jealousy do? It divides. It causes you to maybe even gossip or be bitter. And here's the thing. Here's what happens when that gets into your heart. Maybe it's somebody on your job that the boss gives a little more accolades to, or gets a raise, or gets a position, or it could be 100 different things. I won't go into all of them, but you see this jealousy stir up in your heart, and that jealousy begins to produce all other kinds of fruit, pride to jealousy, and jealousy to backbiting and gossiping and putting people down. All these other things really are the branches of pride in our heart, and it's the opposite of what Jesus taught us to live like. So I want to go to one last passage of Scripture. And when I say last, it's probably 30 minutes. I know you were hopeful, like, oh, good, he's closing last. But all good pastors have three or four closings, and they last longer and longer. But anyway, just turn with me to the book of Philippians. Verse 3 of chapter 2 of Philippians. Here's the text that gives us instruction to what Jesus did when he came in on Palm Sunday, riding on a donkey, lowly. Two times Jesus, that we know of in Scripture, rode a donkey. Interestingly enough, was the first time with his mother when he was still in the womb and he was riding to a manger. Not riding to Herod's court to speak. And the second time he came in on a donkey was into Jerusalem to be crucified on the cross. It shows the humility of Jesus, the simplicity of Jesus. And so Philippians is a letter teaching us how to have that thing that Jesus has. And I don't want to just tell you, don't be prideful and have humility. I want to show you what Scripture says, right, about having that kind of humility. Do nothing. So if you, I don't know if you underline in your Bible or highlight it, if it's on your phone, but highlight the word nothing there. Don't do some things from rivalry and conceit. Do nothing from rivalry and conceit. If that doesn't convict you, not much will. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Just because we allow a little bit of rivalry in our heart, a little bit of conceit. It's like, oh, I'm not as conceited as others. Well, that's comparison right there in itself. All right, so do nothing at all from rivalry or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourself. So it's not just counting others more significant than yourselves, but it's doing it in humility. It's taking the lower seat, as Jesus talked about when you have a wedding feast. You take the lower seat first. Maybe somebody will call you forward, but that's not up to you. That's up to the others in your life. Your role, my role, our responsibility is to always take the lower seat, to always be in humility, counting. This word count here talks about consider, think about, and even count itself. Okay, there's 300-400 people here. I'm not sure what the number is, but if we're following this Scripture, I don't get up here on the stage and say, and forgive me even saying this because it sounds haughty just even thinking about it. I don't get up on the stage and say, I'm David Wilkerson's son, and he wrote The Cross and Switchblade and started Teen Challenge, so you probably know how special I am, right? I can't do that, right? I can't do that. I have to get up here and say, there's 300 people here today, or maybe more, and I have to count myself based on Scripture here, on humility. What does humility do? It counts myself, it counts others more significant than myself. So in God's economy of the count of things, I consider myself, you might be one, you might be two, you might be three, you might be five, 20, 30, you might be 60, you might be 99, you might be 300, then I have to be what? 301. Or in the world today, there are 8 billion people. What do I have to be, according to Scripture, to count? I have to count 8 billion people, 8 billion people more significant than me. But I don't do that, do you? I count myself more significant than most of you in this room because I think about myself more than you do. And there's something in my heart that wishes you would consider me more. I want to be served more. I want to be patted on the back more. I want to be applauded more. And all that comes from this arrogance in us, this pride that the enemy works in our flesh, works in our heart. More significant than yourselves. You're seeing them as significant, as others that you want to serve and bless. And then the verse 5 says, have this mind, which is yours, in among yourself, which is yours. That's a good promise, isn't it? Because this battle with the flesh and the spirit, this battle with humility and pride is so ingrained in our Adamic nature. It requires a revolution of our heart, a reworking of our mind, a reworking of our vision of what life is meant to be. It's not for myself. I'm meant to live for others. Now, it doesn't say you don't have interest, because it says not only your own interest, but also the interest of others. but you have this mind among yourselves, and it's yours in Christ Jesus. It belongs to you. Here's the exciting news about humility. It's never yours in yourself. Because as soon as you start trying to get humility in yourself, you go around telling people how humble you are. Humility and how I obtained it. Title of my new book, Humility and how I've achieved it perfectly. You can't do that. It has to be in Christ Jesus. It's a gift he gives to us, to the hungry heart, to the repentant heart, to the one who recognizes their own arrogance and their own pride and their own selfishness and their own interests that are, excuse me, far more high than our own interest as well. Have this because it's in Christ Jesus. It's yours. It's a gift. And then in verse 7, I read from the ESV, but he made himself. So this is Jesus. It's talking of Jesus. He didn't try to be a little more humble. He made. I'm going to make myself live this way. I'm coming to earth in a manger. I'm getting on a donkey and coming into Jerusalem. They're laying palms down. And these are people that are going to reject me later. But I'm going to walk in humility. And he said, I'm going to make myself. And he says here, but he made himself. And in the ESV, it says nothing. How in the world? If anybody should not make themselves nothing, it should be Jesus, right? I mean, he should make himself like higher than everybody. But he didn't. As a matter of fact, it was his Father that exalted him. He said he made himself nothing, and then the Father highly exalted him, name above all other names. So he's calling us into this lifestyle. How do you become nothing? Well, number one, it's an aspiration. It starts with that. Lord, I've been praying so much for myself. I'm so self-centered. You're looking at me like, why did Pastor Matthew have you preach if you're such a horrible Christian? But you're just as bad as me, so come on, right? If I were to take a picture of this center row here right now, right? And then I showed you that I went down the road. Look at this picture. Where would you zoom out to? All right? Some of you, he's pointing to his wife. You're so sweet. Oh, wow. Next week's sermon is on lying. I'm just teasing. You probably are humble. Yeah, is he? Okay, good. His wife said he's humble. Praise God. Yeah, so. What was I saying? I forgot where I was at. Oh, yeah, you zoom in. So that we have this tendency to look at ourselves, to see ourselves. This is all that I'm talking about here today is the humility of Jesus. And it starts with this conviction, Lord, I'm going to aspire to walk in humility. I'm going to aspire to esteem others more highly than myself. And I won't do this in my own energy, in my own flesh. I'll keep coming back. And it can be very difficult. And what happens in this journey is there's a point of contention. The Holy Spirit contends with us. He did this with me when I was on the phone with my friend Zach. And I said to him, you know, I don't need revival. And all of a sudden, man, it just hit me, and it's been hitting me ever since. That was a point of contention. So the Holy Spirit will contend with you in an area. And then out of that contention, you have a choice to either lean into it and say, yes, Lord, or to try to ignore it and reject it and say, like, well, everybody else is haughty or everybody else is putting themselves first. So let me. And so you reject the contention. And so today, what we're wanting to close with, and the worship team, if you guys don't mind coming back, what we want to close with is allow the Holy Spirit to contend with you today, and let him reveal. Say, yes, Lord, I'm open. It's these things are in my heart, and I don't want them to be. I want to be cleansed of these things, and there's an understanding. You can't do it in your own strength. So stand with me if you would, please. And I just want to pray for people that would be honest enough to say, maybe you're wrestling with some of the same things I'm wrestling with. that I want to break free. And I don't know if until heaven if I'll totally be breaking free from all forms of arrogance and pride. I think it's the flesh, and Paul said the flesh wrestles with the spirit and the spirit with the flesh. So this could be an ongoing thing, but I want major victory. I want breakthrough. I want to be a man of humility, not looking at numbers, not looking at elephants, not being a rabbit that wants to be an elephant, but just going out and just a simple man who just loves Jesus and loves people. So Father, I pray in the name of Jesus for my brothers and sisters who maybe are at a point of, even maybe through this message or something you've been preparing their hearts to hear today, you're contending with them. You're saying, this is an issue that I want you to deal with. This is something I want to call on. I don't know whether I should give an invitation because, you know, I don't want people to have to walk down to the front to say, like, hey, I'm full of pride. But, okay, you just answered my question. So, yeah, we'll open up the altars, okay? And if this is something you're wrestling with, just ask the Lord. Just, Lord, contend with me today, and I choose not to move towards frustration and moving away from what you're calling me to. I want to move into the Spirit of God today. Come forward as we sing this. We'll pray for you in just a moment. For these who have stepped forward, thank you that you're merciful and gracious, and you hear the cry of our heart, and you're moving even right now in our hearts to root out some things that, Lord, I thank you that these people were so hungry for the fullness of God that they're willing to step out of their seats and in a sense confess and admit something that's a struggle for us all to admit. Sometimes it's our pride keeping us back from confessing our pride. And I thank you, God, for those humble hearts. And Lord, I just pray you'd break through in humility. You'd give them that sense of this gift is yours in Christ Jesus. I pray over everyone who's kneeling or standing at this front of the church here today. I pray, Lord Jesus, that you would give them the desire of their heart and the desire of your heart, God, that you would have a church, a bride that walks like you walk, Jesus, not in self-exaltation. That's coming through your Father. But Lord, in your own walk, you walked in humility and meekness and lowliness. And Lord, give us that spirit. Lord, that I believe is the most attractive spirit that this generation will see. I believe it's the most attractive spirit that the world will see around us. Christians who are not haughty and arrogant and always fighting and backbiting, but who love you, love one another, and love the lost. Thank you, Jesus. Do a deep work in our heart. Do a deep work in our heart. God, let this be just the beginning. For me, months ago, it was almost a year now, it was the beginning of a journey, Lord, to reveal as you contended with me, contend with us, God. We're open for you to rebuke, reprove, correct, and then last thing on that list, in Timothy, is to encourage. And Lord, we're not going to leave here today under the weight of rebuke or condemnation at all, for sure. But we're going to leave here today saying, this is the promise of the Lord. I thank you. You don't ever have a word preached without accompanying it with the anointing to accomplish what that work does. And so this work is setting us free from some things in our heart that you've been speaking to us about. So I thank you for this in Jesus' precious name. Let's sing it again and you continue to just pray. Just spend some time with the Lord here this morning.
And I will love you, Lord, my strength. And I will love you, Lord.
Oh,